lessons learned.
Plus new queer music.
That's Sunday, June 25th from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. here on WBAI, listener-sponsored Resistance Radio.
And once again, this is WBAI New York, 99.5 FM and WBAI.org on the web. The previous program was The Jordan Journal with Howard Jordan, heard Friday starting at 3 p.m. Thank you, Earthmom, for those announcements from the Community Bulletin Board. Stay tuned for State of the Arts NYC with Savona Bailey-McClain. Coming up, it is 5 p.m.
NYC, where we cover art. And our theme for this week is true beauty is revealed only if there's light within. And so, with that said, we have joining us, and I'm so excited about this, Orlando Palacio, who is the owner of Worth and Worth Men's Hat. And then we have Gabrielle Ferrara, Vice President of Technology and Innovation at Ferrara Manufacturing. She is also the Secretary of the Board at the New York Garment Center Suppliers Alliance. And then we have Erik Engquist, Assistant Managing Editor at Crain's New York Business, as we continue to explore creative manufacturing and production in New York. So I want to welcome all of our guests in this first segment, Orlando, Gabrielle, and Erik. Welcome, everyone.
Hello. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
This is fantastic. So for the benefit of our audience, we are going to continue this conversation, as I mentioned, about creative manufacturing and production in New York. So Orlando, as I mentioned, is the proprietor of Worth and Worth, and Gabby is also a part of the New York Garment Center Suppliers Alliance, where they are in discussions, negotiations with the city of New York, because the Garment Center might be losing their protective rezoning this year. And Erik with Crain is offering a different perspective, a business perspective that the mayor's office also shares. So I think this will be a very lively conversation as we discuss what might be the future of creative production in New York. So let me start off with Erik. Erik, thank you so much for being here. Tell us a little bit about Crain's perspective about this issue.
Well, Crain's has been covering this issue for, actually since it began, for more than 30 years. Mm. And surprisingly, little has changed as far as city policy since 1987, when there was a special zoning protection put in place for garment manufacturing. Some people trace that deal that was cut at the time to the Koch administration's attempt to clean up Times Square, mm-hmm. and it needed some support from the union that represented garment workers. And so the garment workers union said, well, we'll support that effort to clean up Times Square, but we need some protection for our people.
Okay.
So basically some of the buildings in Midtown, West Midtown, were zoned so that you could only use them for manufacturing space for storage, not for, you know, white-collar offices or anything of that nature. At the time, there were about 90,000 garment center workers.
Correct.
Still making. And so then fast forward to today, de Blasio is in office, and they're looking at the district, and they're saying there are only 5,100 garment workers left, down from 90,000. So clearly, in their view, the rezoning protection hasn't worked, is not working, and so they're proposing to change it. And of course, the folks who have benefited from it from all these years or are still benefiting from it don't want it to change. So that's why there's this controversy over what to do.
Okay. All right. So that gives us some historical background. Okay. So, Gabby, why don't you join in and share with us from a business owner's perspective why you feel that these protections are still needed to this day?
Thank you. So Erik makes a good point. The policy hasn't changed since 1987 when they were originally enacted. But there's a core difference that's in our perspectives. The things that are happening in the garment center are not making pieces. It's highly specialized and niche production. So it needs to be in Manhattan. It needs to have proximity to design, suppliers, all the sort of components of the ecosystem that still exist today in that area.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is it still the size that it was in 1987? Of course not. So we agree that a change needs to happen, but the timeline that the city is proposing to lift the zoning policy this year will eliminate most of what's happening in the garment center and makes it so special and supports the fashion industry as a whole. So what we want to have is a productive conversation with the city to make sure that there's an alternative in place instead of just taking the zoning off and hoping for the best.
Okay, and I like to bring Orlando in because Orlando is not originally from New York City. He's from the West Coast, right?
That's right.
And so New York lured you here. And tell us what lured you here from the West Coast.
You could get anything here. There was this sense that you could see a garment being patterned and then made. There were makers everywhere. There was the boot maker, the hat maker, of course. Just makers of all things and accessories that I think created a life of itself.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember speaking to tourists, and they talk about, New York, you could go to Uncle Sam's, which was an umbrella. You would fix your umbrella. So
mm-hmm.
Where would you take your umbrella if it got broken? And the shoemaker, and just the tailor. And fascinating. And just to see those, the makers and the hands on,
yes.
That it's just not a cookie cutter. It's just not stamped out. I think it's valuable to a human being,
mm-hmm.
to a sense of worth, a sense of where things come from.
Mm-hmm.
And so that brought me here.
All right. And Erik, I mean, hearing that, you know, from a lot of producers, creative producers, that the whole process of making things is being lost, does that factor into some of these decisions you think are being proposed by the city?
Oh, absolutely it does. And in fact, you know, the de Blasio administration has been making a push for years, actually, to preserve well-paying jobs that do not necessarily require a college degree. So that's basically manufacturing jobs, and not just garment, but other kinds of manufacturing. So the administration definitely does not want to lose all these garment district jobs. What it does want to do is move them. And this is where there is some amount of disagreement. There are some folks who feel that it is essential to have the niche garment makers in Midtown because that's where the fashion industry is based, and that's where Broadway is. And, you know, this is where the designers can basically walk a couple of blocks,
right,
and actually see their designs being executed. And so they can say, you know, no, this needs to change, or this needs to be fixed, or that's wonderful, go ahead. You know, they're not making, we're not talking about tube socks, you know, we're not talking about things that are made en masse in Southeast Asia. We're talking about high-end, you know, hands-on products that take a lot of skill,
mm-hmm.
and effort to make. So, you know, but that said, a lot of the square footage that was set aside for garment making is now not being used for garment making. Most of it is being used for storage because there just aren't enough garment workers to fill all that square feet. So you have these landlords who, you know, are kind of stuck with their property, and they're of course itching to rent it out to high-end users. And you know, the de Blasio people would like to see, say, more tech companies come in that also pay very well and would pay much higher rent, and they would. So essentially the plan is to try to shift a lot the remaining or some of the garment district jobs to places like Sunset Park, where there is some active garment making there already.
But that's on the low end, not really high-end manufacturing. That's basically t-shirts,
right. So,
and
yeah. So,
denim.
So the location, yeah, and the location argument is basically, is it essential to have it in Midtown, or is that basically a convenience for the fashion industry folks so they can walk two blocks rather than take a subway ride or an Uber to see their products being made? So that, and I'm not an expert enough in the industry to tell you whether it's a convenience or it's essential, mm-hmm. but I can tell you that the de Blasio people view it as a convenience.
Okay. So, Gabby and Orlando, yeah. Please jump in on this, because I think what there's a disconnect about this creative process, wouldn't you say? Go ahead, Gabby.
Yeah. I mean, I think in regards to your comment about convenience or it being essential, I mean, we're not just talking about the designers here. We're talking about the workers who sometimes don't have a college degree. So those jobs that Blasio is trying to preserve, a lot of those people come from Queens, and they come from the Bronx. They come from New Jersey. They come from Brooklyn. So it's kind of a bullseye on Penn Station. So if you look at a map of all the workers who, by the way, have had decades of training, of refining their craft and how they make things, it's kind of, you know, essential to be near Penn Station and essential to have that public transportation. Is it also really important to be close to your main customer, the designer? Of course.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. So
being in Broadway, being close to Broadway, the designer, a Broadway show needs something, needs a fitting for a star. You're just down the street. Your laborer, your craftsman, your craftsperson, that they are coming from Queens. They are coming from New Jersey. You move the garment district away from there. You move it into Sunset Park. The manufacturer lost that hand. Because you're not going to, that craftsperson is not going to travel 1 hour and a half each way, 3 hours a day, when they are supporting a family. It's highly unlikely. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, you've just broken the soul of a maker, mm-hmm. because he can no longer make what he has learned to do.
Mm-hmm. And I think maybe, you know, also...
I was just going to say one more thing. It's amazing to me because London, Milan, these cities are around the world are trying to get people like Orlando to come to their cities, because when you attract creatives, you create culture, you create value, which ultimately, you know, drives real estate costs up. But also interest and dynamic activity in a city. So, you know, people like Orlando aren't going to show up to New York City if there's no convenience and that sort of soul of making and being able to go to your factory and your suppliers.
Just
all
like you said, if there is no
5-minute walk.
Yeah,
yeah,
absolutely. There is no soul.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but this is, I just want to put on, I'm not an economist, but I want to try to put on an economist hat for
go
a
ahead.
Second.
No,
here.
No,
say,
that's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
So this is where, the economists will come in and say, there's always an amount of messiness when you have a capitalist society because things change, right? Trends change. You know, at one time in 1970, there were 200,000 clothing manufacturing jobs in New York City. 200,000. Not all in the garment district, but 200,000. You know, and today there are fewer than 14,000. So, yes, those jobs that you were talking about, they have been lost. So those folks who used to commute to jobs, you know, we're talking 186,000 workers are not doing what they were doing. And it is always sad when jobs and industries are lost or changed or shrink significantly. But, again, the economists will say, has New York collapsed in that time? Has New York culture collapsed? Has the economy collapsed because we lost those jobs? No, they've just changed to other things. So now we have
a
lot
more
workers in different.
How long have you been in
New York? 47 years.
47 years.
No, he's born and raised here in Brooklyn.
So you think that the culture is not lost in New York City?
It has changed, but I still think
culture,
New York City.
Define
is
culture for me.
Well, it's New York City is one of the cultural capitals of the world. Is it the same? Do we have the exact same culture that we had, you know, when I was born in 1969? No, we don't. But we still have culture here. We still have an active art scene, theater scene.
I think what it is that what many people are arguing today is that the cultural scene that we have today has shifted out of the hands of everybody and into the hands of just the few. So nowadays, you have fewer people that collect art. You can see that from the auction house prices right now. It's just the super rich that are able to buy, you know, certain important pieces of work. And you have everyday people who are not engaging in different types of activities because they don't believe it's meant for them. It's meant for somebody else. And what used to be taken for granted in the garment district where anyone can go and get a hat made, a dress made, a glove made, a shoe made, is now, you know, people don't even realize that these garments are even made in New York City anymore, that everything is in China. So I think what has happened is that because of high labor costs and health insurance costs that we never dealt with in the past, now we're still not totally dealing with it now, people feel that everything is outsourced and there's nothing here in the United States anymore, in New York anymore. And I'm just going to ask, how do we begin to turn that around? Because even if you have to reduce the footprint of the garment district, wouldn't you say that still having that is still important, Erik?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, and so, and this is where the timing issue, which has been raised already, you know, is so important here, and that's a large part of this fight. It's like the timing of this. And the Blasio people have, to their credit, have put this on hold just to make sure they get this right. Because if you get rid of the zoning protection before you create alternatives, then there's going to be this gap. And by the time you create the alternatives, you may have lost a lot of the businesses mm-hmm. that were there, right? I think mm-hmm. that's the point you were raising.
Yes, yes.
So this idea of shifting the jobs to Sunset Park, you want to make sure that's ready and that people can make that move before, you know, they lose their leases in Midtown.
But what
once they lose those leases, they're not getting them back.
Right, but what if they don't want to go? Like Gabby, your firm, they don't want to move to Sunset Park, correct?
Yeah, and I mean, we've been conducting a survey, which we are not complete yet, but we've been going around to the factories in the area and asking them what they think of Brooklyn, what they think of their business, of the zoning proposed changed. And what we're finding is, you know, a lot of these businesses have been around for 20, 30 years. They're going to shut down if they are forced to move to Brooklyn. So that's not really in the cards for them. And it won't be for, you know, the foreseeable future until Brooklyn has proved to become a viable option, mm-hmm. which, you know, we're not convinced that it ever will be. But there are very few firms that will end up moving to Brooklyn, especially the ones that depend on proximity to designers because of, you know, working on runway garments, or highly specialized functions that require proximity to designers, suppliers, and other manufacturers.
Okay, all right. So this is going to be a long debate where people need to figure out how to, you know, compromise on something that's really important to New York City. Because even if it's just how many jobs left, Erik, 5,000
in the garment district, about 5,100 jobs citywide, just under 14,000 jobs. You know, so although, and I just want to say that, that to put it in context, that's about 0.3% of the entire New York City workforce. Not to minimize it, but you know, we are talking about a small niche of the economy, but one that, you know, people who have been around a while, you know, remember and identify with. And, you know, of course, there's nothing wrong with that. But, you know, as when I was a kid, we had a lot more bookstores. We had a lot more record shops. You know, there was a whole series of stores where you could take your instruments to get repaired, you know, on 47th Street. And
yeah.
Those are, all, you know, those are, for the most part, they're gone. Like, the Amazon has taken over much of the book trade, and, you know, internet sales have moved a lot of, you know, there are no record, not too many record shops anymore because everyone gets their music digitally. So did the city put in protections to, like, guarantee that those stores could keep their leases? No, they didn't, and we lost them, and it's always sad when that happens. But other people have moved in, other industries have moved in, and, you know, New York has changed and it has moved on from some of those stores.
Erik, I'm sorry, I just have to jump in right here, but the factories in the garment center aren't the equivalent of, you know, bookstores going out of business. There's actually been an increase in smaller factories coming back to the United States.
Absolutely.
This year, I believe, was the first year we're seeing that. And as technology basically automates some of the lower value jobs, we're actually able to bring a lot of these high-value production factories and operations back to the United States. So we take out the Garment Center, which is, again, a group of businesses, but also workers who have, you know, decades of experience. And then you introduce this new trend of small manufacturing coming back to the United States, and you lose a huge opportunity of being able to capitalize on this new technology that's being integrated into the production process. And, you know, so it's not a bookstore. It's a full industry. Mm-hmm. And it's the
And we have, and you're right, those jobs have stabilized. You know, manufacturing, it was whittled down for decades, and then it stabilized citywide at about maybe 77,000 jobs, and has pretty much hovered there. It's like held its ground, so it's holding on. And you're right, we're seeing more of these skilled manufacturing jobs, and the city has set aside 17 industrial business zones that are designed to, you know, to protect these kinds of businesses. For the most part, they're not in Midtown. For the most part, they're in places like North Brooklyn, Long Island City, so where the rents are a little bit lower. And then so, but there's just, you know, the reason that there's a focus on Midtown is because there's such a mismatch between, you know, the rent that a manufacturer can pay and a rent that, like, a high-end white shoe law firm can pay or Google can pay, you know, something like that. And, of course, you know, the square footage is now mismatched with the number of people who are actually working there. I think in the end, we're going to see some kind of a compromise where there'll be some smaller amount of protection in Midtown, where there'll be a change in the timing so that people aren't, you know, left with no place to go for a period of months and then they have to close. I do think that will emerge, but it's going to take some work because, you know, it's a very emotional issue. And again, this debate has actually gone on since the beginning of the Bloomberg administration and has not been resolved.
All right. And like Orlando, you were telling me, like, you moved. You used to be at 37th Street. Now you're in the 50s. And
I'm on 57th between Park and Madison.
And your clientele is there. And the
Absolutely.
Proximity of being next to your clientele has made a difference for your business.
Well, that and the fact that you can walk into a shop and see it being made, I think, changed the whole thought pattern of why you're paying X amount of dollars for a quality product. It's not something that's stamped out, and I think that's what we try to maintain, is that it's a craftsman. There's a person that leaves a thread to your product. And we decided 15, 17 years ago that we would move everything north, closer to Central Park, closer to the hub of those who can afford it. And by doing that, we were able to sustain our highly skilled worker and manufacture a quality product and still have that culture mm-hmm. of New York, where there's something made, that there, like, there's someone there that's actually making it, and there are these machines that are 70, 60 years old, and they're working.
Mm-hmm.
And we're working.
And I think also, this is just for the benefit of our audience, I think it's important for people just to understand that this is a delicate situation, because these manufacturers, these creative producers, they actually pay decent salaries and health insurance, correct? Orlando
Absolutely.
And Gabby, y'all pay health insurance, offer a vacation. You actually take care of the workers. They're almost like family to you, correct?
Absolutely.
Yes, I mean, my assistant's been with me 15 years. The boys who started as interns of now are 5 years and 4 years, and they're brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And they're family. You mm-hmm. watch them grow. You push them for higher education. You go to their birthdays. You go to their graduations.
And I think maybe that's what a lot of these businesses are trying to say, which I think that is what's being lost in New York City. The garment district represents a sort of
community.
Yeah, an old community where people actually looked out for each other. And in our political environment right now, it just seems to be the reverse. Wouldn't you agree, at least to that, Erik, that, you know, what the GOP just offered as a health care benefit would throw millions off of health care?
You know, it's interesting because I do agree, and we see it not just in manufacturing, but we see it in a bunch of other industries as well. In fact, I just fielded this incredibly emotional op-ed that was sent to me by a chef, an executive mm-hmm. chef, who had a restaurant on Second Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't the owner, he was the chef. But he was there for 19 years.
Wow.
And he said, you know, it was a very stable staff, which is unusual in the restaurant industry, but he had his kitchen had no turnover for 10 years, and they were like a family.
Absolutely.
And then what happened? You know, 16 months ago, the landlord of the building hired a consultant, and the consultant said, you know, you should be getting twice as much rent as you're getting for this spot. And so they went to the restaurateur and said, we're going to have to double your rent. And he said, of course, I can't afford that. And he closed it.
Mm.
And so since then, the building, that spot has been vacant since then, which is a loss for the neighborhood.
Yes.
You know, the family of the restaurateur could not open up somewhere else. The second time his heart had been broken for the same reason, lost his lease because the rent went up. And he did not reopen, so everyone went their separate ways. It was literally like a family broken up. So, you know, very difficult. And what has happened as a result of these kinds of situations, especially because chain stores often come in and fill these spots, you know, the drugstore chains mm-hmm. and places like that, Starbucks. There has been a movement that has popped up that said, we need commercial rent control. We need
yes.
the same thing
yes.
that residents
that.
Have in a million apartments where, you know, there's a regulation where you can't just kick them out and you can't raise their rent more than X percent or whatever the rent guidelines board says you're allowed to. And so there's been a bill kicking around the city council for years. I'm not sure that it's ever going to pass,
mm-hmm.
but there are some people in the small business community who are very, very, you know, they really have poured years of effort into getting this kind of protection, and it hasn't happened. I'm not sure that it's going to happen, and a lot of people say it should not happen because, you know, if you provide special protections, then it can hold back your economy. That means, you know, the tech sector, which I know de Blasio and Bloomberg before him, they're trying to grow the tech sector, and they're trying to grow biotech and some other exciting things. And if every space is reserved in some way for this industry or that, for legacy industries, that means you don't get that kind of creative destruction or new folks coming in. So, you know, it's a blessing and a curse
when you have
this kind of change.
And I'm for new technology. I really am. And you talked about biotechnology. That's even entering in the fashion world, too. I'm all for that. I'm just thinking that we don't need to throw the baby and the bathwater out at the same time, that there is a way that we can nurture people and actually help them to grow, because some of these businesses might want to expand into these new technologies. Like Gabby, you were telling me about prototyping. Your operation deals for prototyping, correct?
So that's one of the things that we're exploring right now. It's actually really cool stuff. It's basically taking a 3D scanner, scanning the customer, and then developing a 2D pattern that custom fits that person. So that's just one way that technology can be introduced to achieve customization. And that's only the beginning. So I think a lot of factories and production houses would love to integrate that technology into their business. It's expensive and the machinery is big. So when you have a lease that's up in 6 months or a year, it's not really interesting to invest in that type of technology. Mm-hmm. So I think there's plenty of room for fashion to become more of a technology forward industry, especially in, you know, what I think is an R&D hub. In the garment center, we just need to give them time. 6 months is not enough time on a lease to invest in a business.
Okay.
So
I think this was good. I just want to, we're getting ready to wrap up this, and I'm going to ask Orlando to, you know, end with, you know, some of his feelings. But I think this was very good, just that we had different perspectives talking together, debating together, no one judging anyone, and informing our listeners, because maybe the general public might want to weigh in too, and may not even realize that they could be even more supportive for both new industry as well as established industries as well, or legacy industries. I like that term, Erik. So, Orlando, just let us know before we end this segment, just how do you feel about, you know, being someone who came all the way from California to New York because you thought this was the greatest city in the world?
As a maker, I wanted to do something that would go beyond me. I wanted to create a business that it didn't stop when I left.
Ah.
Because if it stopped when I left, then it was an ego trip. If it carried on, as the American Indian would say, I left a thread. And so that's what I came out to do, and that's what I'm doing. And that's why I feel so passionate about it. And with God's grace, you know, it'll happen. It will. And I am making it happen.
All right. Well, thank you guys for joining us, particularly Erik, for taking the time. I know today is your, like, deadline day.
Yeah, we're producing Monday's print paper. I'm sure my boss is wondering where I am right now.
Okay.
It's really been a great opportunity.
Man.
Well,
thank you. It's really been great.
Thank you all. And we're going to take a break now. Thank you. Are back with State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. And I think we really did cover some art today. We had some great guests on our show. We had Erik Engquist, who heads Crain's political coverage and pens the masthead editorial and edits Crain's Insider. He covers everything that's politics. And we had Orlando Palacios, who is an artist and master craftsman and the proprietor behind the storied New York brand Worth and Worth. And we had with us Gabrielle Ferrara. She is the vice president of technology, and she is the secretary for the Garment District Suppliers Alliance, and she was there to share with us information about what they are trying to do to save the Garment District. I thought that was great. We have people with different perspectives that didn't necessarily agree with each other, but I thought it was great because the public needs to know about what's going on when it comes to creative production and manufacturing. It is not just about the Garment District. It's those who deal with landscaping, those who deal with making lights, designers. May was Design Month, and we had a lot of designers from Brooklyn Design, Wanted Design. And we're getting ready to talk about a glassmaker. I mean, a master glassmaker, Dale Chihuly, whose exhibition is now at the New York Botanical Garden, his first major garden exhibition in New York in more than 10 years. And so we are about to have Barbara, who is the public and education vice president at the New York Botanical Garden, and she is going to tell us, because she deals with continuing education and public education for the New York Botanical Garden, about this special exhibition. So, Barbara, thank you so much for joining us.
Hi there. How are you?
I'm fine, and thank you again. It's great to have the New York Botanical Garden back with us. Tell us about these beautiful glassworks at the New York Botanical Garden.
Well, this year, really, the wonderful thing about the Chihuly exhibition, it's more than 20 monumental sculptures of glass that are just, you know, dotting the landscape of the garden. And this year, this time around, the exhibition is particularly amazing at night,
mm-hmm.
because all of the sculptures are spectacularly illuminated from within.
Aren't you lighting up tomorrow evening?
Saturday night, yep.
Yes.
Tomorrow we have, you know, a Chihuly night. We have many of them throughout the exhibition. In the either Thursday night, some of them are Thursdays or Saturday nights. And then in the fall, they'll go to Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night.
I'm thinking about going tomorrow night.
Oh. Well, you should come for any one of the Chihuly nights. They're fun. They're not just, you know, there's music, live music. We have performers strolling through the garden, food, drink. It's just a fun night.
It is.
Good getaway. It's nice to see the garden at night, too. It's just, you know, you can stroll through the native plant garden, go into the conservatory. The buildings look fabulous. It's just a really nice night.
I think I'm going to do it because one of the reasons why I brought the New York Botanical Garden to the show once before,
mm-hmm.
and I spoke to your other colleagues because I'm a Bronx girl. I was born and raised in the Bronx, but that's
yes,
not my primary reason. I absolutely feel that the New York Botanical Garden is one of the most beautiful spaces in all of New York City. And I've been a member. I've taken other family members. I just love it. And
well, thank you. Thank you for your support.
I really believe it's beautiful. And now to know that you're doing something nighttime,
I don't know if you also know, if you maybe talked about it a little bit already, but one of the new things that we have for this year is we have jazz and Chihuly nights.
No, we haven't talked about it yet. We've posted it online, but please tell us about the summer concert series, Jazz and Chihuly.
Sure. Well, so last June, for the garden's 125th anniversary, we had jazz at Lincoln Center with Wynton Marsalis perform on the conservatory lawn to over 1,000 people.
that
and it was really a very successful, fantastic night for the garden. Mm-hmm. So this year we decided to expand on that with three Friday night jazz concerts in June, July, and August during the Garden's Chihuly exhibition.
Okay.
So what we partnered with Danny Melnick, who's a veteran, you know, producer of the Newport Jazz Festival, among others, and with Piers Playfair, who founded the Catskill Jazz Factory. And I love the Catskill Jazz Factory. I don't know about, if you know much about them, but basically they bring together and assemble just the finest young jazz musicians and provide them a platform, various platforms for performing. And on top of that, they come up with these very strong program concepts like The French Connection or 100 Years of Jazz or Songs of Protest and Reconciliation. So there's very dynamic, appealing programs with very dynamic musicians.
Yes, I see they got like Damien Sneed, who's going to be doing some work. I mean, he's a multi-genre recording artist, and he's also done some things at the New School, and I also think at the White House, too, correct?
Oh, yes, he has. Yes, he has. He's great. He's going to be with us in August. And then in July, on July 14th, we have the celebrating 100 years of jazz with Chris Washburn, many other fine jazz musicians and vocalists. It's going to be a big, big night for us. We've already sold us over 1,000 tickets to that.
Whoa.
Yeah. There's a big buzz about it.
I better hurry up and get me a ticket.
What's that?
I said, I better hurry up and get me one of those tickets.
You better. No, the night's really great because you have, so you've got this amazing night of jazz on the conservatory lawn, which is just this beautiful, lush, green lawn. You know, you bring your picnic basket. You can order a picnic box online. You know, the concert starts at 7, and it goes from 7 to 8:30. You're just surrounded by these magnificent old trees on this beautiful lawn with the conservatory dome as the backdrop. And right after the concert, you know, just when it's starting to get dusk and it's going into dark, all of the sculptures are lit up. So, you know, you're in this kind of magical environment. You've just heard this great jazz, and then you just can stroll around and see all the beautiful sculpture at night.
It's funny that you mentioned that. You don't know this, but prior to your joining our show, we just had a very lively conversation talking about, you know, traditions and its relationship to something very emotional, the garment district. And before the show, I was speaking with one of the guests, Orlando Palacios, and we were just talking about that, how we've taken a lot of things for granted. You know, people used to go get beautiful hats and dresses and suits. And then I think about what you just said about being amongst old trees and laying on a garden, you know, lawn and having a picnic basket. And I love the fact that what we're trying to do on this show is let people know that you can live a creative life. And that could be just listening to world-class jazz or looking at beautiful glass works or strolling and promenading around, you know, this magnificent space
garden
in the Bronx. Yes, this garden. And I think that's what you guys are trying to do, are you not?
Yeah, we're really trying to create just a full sensory experience.
A little
bit of
magic.
It's a complete nature fix. It's a music fix. It's an art fix. And it's all, you know, just in a really relaxed, magical environment.
Yes, and it's open for anyone. It's not for one group versus another. It's for any average person, you know.
Save
up
so
for
accessible.
A ticket and sit down and, you know, rub elbows with other New Yorkers and just enjoy the summer in a beautiful way. And you also are extending this into the early fall, too, correct?
Yeah, well, the jazz nights are just, there's just two of them left, you know. July 14th and August 18th. But the Chihuly nights are going in, which are just, you know, they're very much the same experience without the jazz concert. But you still get, there's still, you know, live music. It's not really a concert, but, you know, there's other kind of, but the sculptures are lit up at night, and then that Chihuly is the main draw there.
And this is also new for you guys, because I remember when you first started bringing sculptures to the garden. Mm-hmm. My favorite still. I love all of them, but I love the Henry Moore exhibition.
Yes. One of my favorites, too.
Oh, God, it was humbling.
I was just a member then. I did not work there yet, but I went to see it, and I, you know, for me it was a dream come true because I love Henry Moore, and seeing those sculptures in that garden setting, I just thought, wouldn't it be great to work here? And then thankfully I got a job there, but that was a really great exhibition.
Yeah.
Manolo Valdez was also beautiful. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Frida Kahlo was very special. We didn't have sculpture in the garden.
I missed that one. I was like, I was like, oh, my God. Everyone said, did you get a chance to go? I said, oh, God, I'm missing it. I missed that one. But it was like, it was just when you go and see these sculptures, and I've seen the images of the glass sculptures, mm-hmm. and I love glass. Glass has become a really beautiful fine art. I mean, it always was there, but it was like a lot of functional pieces. But now you're seeing people really develop these magnificent abstract works. And that's what Dale Chihuly, I hope I'm saying his name correctly.
Yeah, Dale Chihuly.
Is all about, where he wanted to experiment with all of these possibilities.
Yeah, well, you look at these sculptures and you hear so many people as you walk past them, you bring people through, just say, how did he do it? Because they're so monumental.
Mm-hmm.
And the glass is so saturated with color.
Yes.
And, you know, the shapes really are just beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all kind of mixed in the naturescape. So
yes.
the way the planting surround the glass has been very artfully done.
Mm-hmm.
There's three of them in the water features in the native plant garden,
mm-hmm.
inside the water. So the reflections in the water are just really beautiful.
It allows you to just imagine, and that's what I liked about them, that you have that moment to pause, because I think sometimes we're overstressed in our day-to-day life,
mm-hmm.
and we do need a little bit of, you know, magic. And seeing that and being able to be surrounded by other people who want to appreciate it as well. And then the music component to what you're doing, I think it offers a real full package.
It is. It just really is that. It's, you know, people come out of there feeling like they just are energized. Because, you know, there's this combination of you have the music, but you also have the stillness.
Mm.
Because when you're walking through the native plant garden, where you're kind of, you're far away from the music at that point, it's just so quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you can really take it in.
Right.
And it's just, you know, that you smell the plants. There's, you know, lots of blooms.
Lots of roses, too.
The roses. It's different depending on when you come. There's always something blooming.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And it's just a fabulous night out.
And I just want to encourage our listeners, just as we're about to wrap up, that, mm-hmm. you know, it's not that difficult to get to the New York Botanical Garden. It's very easy to get there.
Yeah, you take the D train, the subway, you can take... also Metro North from Grand Central train. Mm-hmm. That's a 18-minute train ride.
Yeah, and
from Grand Central.
And then you could go to some of the nearby neighborhoods like Arthur Avenue.
Yeah.
Get some good Italian food and cannolis. I love the cannolis that are over there.
I can tell you're a Bronx girl.
I am a Bronx girl. I mean, there's a lot of people who grew up in the Bronx. Robert De Niro and,
you know,
lots of great actors.
No.
I remember Doris Roberts. Many of us celebrated when they renovated the Lowe's Paradise Theater that was on the Grand Concourse. I was a little girl when my mother took me and my sister. So, yeah, people don't realize some of the beauty that's right here in this city. And we just, you know, move about. But that's what I like about the New York Botanical Garden. It allows you to pause. And maybe
mm-hmm.
by pausing, we'll start to, you know, relish some of the traditions that many of us, you know, are afraid of slipping away. So
people in the Bronx know the New York Botanical Garden and they treasure it. It mm-hmm. is a treasure of the Bronx. But people sometimes who finally get out here from, you know, Manhattan or Brooklyn or the other boroughs just say, I did not know this was here. I love this, you know.
I even loved it. I found a big turtle in the garden when I was doing the forest path, and this big turtle was there. And people don't realize you can also You know, that you guys have rowboats and
yeah.
That take you down the river inside the garden.
Oh, yeah. You can canoe on the Bronx River.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in the fall, we do have canoe trips in that part of the Bronx. No, it's like it's a great little urban oasis.
Yes.
It's a real nature fix. It's
yes.
a 20-minute getaway. You know, it's really great to come in the summer at night.
I just want to thank you so much for coming on our show today and sharing with us. And thank you so much again for
thank you for inviting me.
The artist. I think this was wonderful. Thank
well,
you.
Come
again.
Visit us.
I'm going to try to get my ticket for
okay,
tomorrow.
Get up here.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right. Take care.
And we are back with State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. I just want to thank Barbara Corcoran, who is the Vice President for Continuing Education and Public Outreach, for joining us tonight. We're sorry we weren't able to get the Catskill folks. We might be able to pick them up next week, but if you can this weekend, go to Chihuly, go to the Botanical Garden at night and enjoy the beautiful glass sculptures that are there and that nice, wonderful pace that we can enjoy in New York City. So I just want to thank everyone for listening to us today. We had a great show and great guests. And so we want you all to have an artful week, and we will see you next Friday. Bye-bye.
I'm Jesse Lent with a WBAI Resistance Calendar. On Friday, June 23rd at 2 p.m., the 13th Annual Trans Day of Action will be held in Manhattan's Washington Square Park. We call on our communities of trans and gender nonconforming people, people of color, and our allies to come together and join Trans Justice as we mobilize for our 13th Annual NYC Trans Day of Action for Social and Economic Justice, reads a statement on the event from organizers. We live in a time when oppressed peoples, including people of color, immigrants, youth and elders, people with disabilities, women, trans and gender nonconforming people, and poor people are underserved, face higher levels of discrimination, heightened surveillance, and experience increased violence at the hands of the state. We must unite and work together towards dismantling the transphobia, racism, classism, sexism, ageism, ableism, homophobia, and xenophobia that permeates our movements for social justice. Participants will gather at Garibaldi Plaza near the east side of the park at 1:30 p.m. Email doa@alp.org for more details. Then on Sunday, June 25th at 3 p.m., Get Organized BK is holding a civic festival focusing on resistance and community building at the Prospect Park Bandshell at Prospect Park West and 9th Street in Brooklyn. One thing we've seen powerfully from the Women's March to the Climate March is that our resistance can also be joyful, event organizers say. Even as we are fighting harm, we are building new relationships and celebrating our values. This festive civic gathering will be an opportunity to highlight the ongoing work of our members, bring new people into the movement, and offer a glimpse of the deepening of resistance work into longer-term community building. Find out more at GetOrganizedBK.org. And at 9:30 a.m. on Wednesday, June 28th, the organization NYC4CEDAW will host a day of action beginning in Brooklyn Bridge Park by walking across the bridge to the steps of City Hall in Lower Manhattan, where there will be a rally at noon with members of more than 200 local organizations and community groups. The objective, according to an official NYC 4CE DAW statement, is to pass, quote, a Women's Bill of Rights, which honors and reflects the obligations outlined in the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, to properly support and fund programming to positively benefit women in all five boroughs. Find out more by sending an email to nyc4cedaw.info@gmail.com or by going to the website nyc4cedaw.org. On Sunday, July 2nd, New York City will join sister cities around the world to march for the impeachment of Donald J. Trump. Donald Trump has been in blatant violation of the Constitution from the day he was sworn into the office of president, reads the marcher's mission statement. It is time that congressional representatives do their job and start the process to impeach this president. We believe President Trump has committed constitutional breaches, consistently lied, cheated, and enforces laws that primarily benefit him and his billionaire friends at the expense of the country. The impeachment march begins at 11 a.m. at 61st Street and Central Park West. You can enter the park at 65th Street. For more information, go to impeachmentmarch.org. That's the WBAI Resistance Calendar for the week ending Saturday, June 24th. I'm Jesse Lent.
In 1949, George Orwell published 1984, a warning of what it might be like to have a government spying on its people, combined with no civil liberty protections and determined to edit historical records to only say what the government wants people to know. And with our new President Trump in office, it seems as though Orwell's warning has come to fruition. Big Brother's definitely watching you. Like, right now. On June 27th, from 9 a.m. to midnight, join WBAI for a Pacifica Radio national broadcast of the iconic 1975 reading of George Orwell's 1984. That's Tuesday, June 27th, starting at 9 a.m. until midnight.
This year, previously apolitical LGBTQ pride parades around the country, under pressure from grassroots activists outraged by the Trump regime's oppressive policies, have reluctantly become resistance marches.
Tune in to WBAI's annual Pride special this Sunday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m.
The Out FM Collective and other producers will cover resistance contingents.
We will also bring you segments on the Trans Day of Action, Gays Against Guns,
the CUNY Center for Lesbian and Gay Studies,
LGBT people in Indonesia, and more.
You'll hear excerpts of last Sunday's remarkable conference, 30 Years of ACT UP, Hidden Histories and Voices, Lessons Learned.
Plus new queer music.
That's Sunday, June 25th, from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. here on WBAI, listener-sponsored Resistance Radio.
On Saturday, June 24th, the People's Organization for Progress will be holding a march and rally for reparations in Newark, New Jersey, 12 noon in front of the Lincoln Monument on West Market Street. One of the core demands of the organization is reparations to all African Americans for centuries of enslavement and brutalization by the U.S. government. Most recently, the UN calls enslavement and colonialism crimes against humanity and urged the U.S. to address these crimes against African people with reparatory justice. So come out on Saturday, June 24th, 12 noon, Newark, New Jersey, at the Lincoln Statue on West Market Street. Reparations are just and reparations are due. For more info, please call 973-801-0001.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am Isaac Ferguson, historian of the award-winning Midnight Ravers, inviting you to join us this Friday, June 23, 2017, from midnight to 2 a.m., when we will rebroadcast, by popular demand, our presentation of Juneteenth, the story of how thousands of African-American slaves were kept toiling in chattel slavery for several years after President Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation, totally uninformed and unaware that they had been freed. Please tune in to WBAI 99.5 FM in New York or WBAI.org on the web, midnight Friday, June 23rd,